This is the Homestead Journey Podcast, the podcast dedicated to the pursuit of self-sufficiency, self-reliance, and sustainability. This is episode number 40. Welcome, welcome, welcome to another episode of the Homestead Journey Podcast. I am so glad that you are here and so appreciative of the fact that you are taking time out of your busy schedule to join us here on the podcast. My name is Brian Wells. I am coming to you from 3B Farm and Homestead here in beautiful and blazing hot upstate New York. Yes, folks, it is hotter than a totter. Now, I have no idea what a totter is, but my buddy, Brian, who was my best friend in high school, he always used to say hotter than a totter. I have no idea what a totter is, but it is certainly hotter than one of those right now. We are enjoying that wonderful time of summer. Now, for those of you down south, quite frankly, the weather that we're dealing with right now, I think it's about 94, 95 degrees outside. If you're from Texas or Mississippi, Louisiana, maybe Alabama, to you, this is nothing. But for us, this is hot and it is humid right now. So we are currently under a heat advisory. And so because of that, I am actually indoors on a Sunday afternoon recording this podcast. Usually I record these podcasts on Sunday evenings, but because it is so blazing hot outdoors, I figured I would come indoors into the AC, I'd record the podcast, and then we will see tonight if I have any ambition left to go out and get a few tasks done here on the homestead. Anyhow, having said that, let's jump right into this week's Homestead Happenings, and I will bring you up to speed with what's been going on here on 3B Farm and Homestead. Well, honestly, not as much got done on the homestead this week as I would have liked. I have been struggling with a little bit of sickness here this week, nothing major, just because of the environment in which we are living right now. My doctor did send me for a COVID test, does not think that I am COVID positive, but out of an abundance of caution, they did send me for a test. So I'm waiting for those results. And right now, just staying away from people, which is not hard to do. I do like spending time here on the homestead. But there were a couple of days where I didn't get a whole heck of a lot done just because I wasn't feeling well. And then you couple that with the heat and humidity, and that certainly zaps you. And so some of the things that I had on my list, things that I wanted to get done this week, I have pushed off until next week. But we still did have a very good week here on the homestead, in particular with the garden. The garden is just starting to come on really, really well now. And we are enjoying so many great things from the garden. In fact, today I posted a picture on our Instagram account and also shared it to Facebook. So if you're not following us on either one of those places, I'd recommend you do so. The links are in the show notes, but you can just look for the Homestead Journey Podcast both on Facebook and Instagram. Anyhow, I shared a picture today of a plate of food. And on that plate of food, everything but the potatoes and the herbs and spices were produced right here on our homestead. And that's just such an incredibly satisfying feeling. And it won't be long, and hopefully we will be adding potatoes to our plates from our homestead because they're looking really, really nice there in the Ruth Stout bed. But this week we harvested zucchini and summer squash, patty pan squash, our first cucumbers, beets and turnips, peas, broccoli, carrots, and of course more beans. And so this week we did some more dehydrating experiments with zucchini and summer squash. And so excited to see how that works out. I've dehydrated them and then we're going to actually reconstitute them and see how they taste and what we think about that. I also made some quick pickles with cucumbers, and so got those in the fridge, kind of drawing up those flavors. I like to let them set a little longer than most people do for quick pickles, just because I like to draw those flavors through, but they're in the fridge. We enjoyed some roasted root vegetables, so beets and turnips together, and they were just absolutely scrumptious. Of course, steamed peas, steamed broccoli, and my wife thinned the carrots. We enjoyed some carrots this week, and oh my goodness, they were so good. And then, of course, this week, we continued canning beans. The beans aren't coming on quite as heavy as I would like, so I'm canning like 5 pints or 4 pints at a time, which isn't the most efficient way to do it, but it is what it is. If that's what you got, that's what you got, that's what you do. I do have one full row of beans in the Ruth Stout bed that's getting ready to come on, and so I think once that hits, we're really going to see our bean canning enterprise shoot up. So even in spite of the sickness and the weather, it's been a great week here on the homestead. All right, let's jump over to this week's charting the course. This week, a friend of mine offered me his roosters. He ordered a bunch of standard breed chickens back in the spring, and they were supposed to be all females, and he got a whole bunch of roosters. And so he's trying to figure out what to do with them. He didn't really want to worry about dressing them off. Right now, you can't get an appointment with anybody to do your poultry anywhere near us. They're booked out until next year. And so he said to me, do you want the roosters? And I said to him, I said, well, I'll just dress them off and give them back to you. He says, I don't want them. He said, the only thing that I ask for are the feet and the rooster combs back. I said, well, the feet, I get that, but the rooster combs, why do you want the rooster combs? Well, come to find out, his wife works with someone who is originally, I believe, from Ecuador, but please don't hold me to that. It's someplace down in South America. And she cooks with cockscombs. That was the first time I had ever heard of anyone cooking with rooster combs. I had never heard of that. Now, I had heard of using the head in stock, but again, I had never heard specifically of using cockscombs in cooking. And so today I thought, you know, it would be a great time for us to talk about using the whole bird. And when I mean the whole bird, I mean every usable part. Now, if you Google how to use a whole chicken, most of the time they're going to instruct you on how to use a dressed bird, right? This would be without the head, the feet, or the guts. But we're homesteaders, right? Our goal is to never let anything usable go to waste. Now, a lot of times when they talk about, you know, for example, using a pig, they'll talk about nose-to-tail cooking, right? Same thing with even with beef, nose-to-tail cooking. And in fact, with pigs, sometimes people will jokingly say you use everything but the squeal. But what about a chicken? Now, there's a bunch of people right now who are raising meat birds for the first time ever in their lives. And there's a lot of people that are learning how to butcher meat birds. They've never butchered a chicken before, and they're learning how to process these animals for the first time in their lives. And so because of that, and you may find yourself as one of those people, you have access to certain parts of the chicken that maybe you have never had access to before, or you've at least never been interested in using before, right? Quite frankly, we don't usually see chicken feet in most American grocery stores. Now, if you go to ethnic grocery stores or you shop at farmers markets in the city, then you may have seen chicken feet, chicken hearts, chicken gizzards, those kinds of things there. But by and large, well, chicken hearts and chicken gizzards you can usually find in a regular grocery store. I'm talking about the average American grocery store, like a Kroger, Albertson, Piggly Wiggly. It's one of my favorite grocery store names of all time, Piggly Wiggly, Publix, Hannaford, you know what I'm talking about. And even with the hearts and the gizzards, those kinds of things, the livers, many times I shouldn't say many times, but sometimes those will come tucked inside the chicken, although generally speaking, that's more common with turkey than it is with whole chickens. But most people, if they get the giblets, they're going to use them maybe in gravy and that's it. But most of us have never considered cooking with them in quantity, right? We've never thought about cooking an entire dish with nothing but chicken hearts or chicken gizzards. And so today, I thought it would be fun for us, instead of from nose to tail, we're going to call it from beak to butt. How to use almost every part of the chicken. Now, certainly, don't take this as a mandate. Please, 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 folks. We're going to have a little bit of fun with this. This is all absolutely possible, but I don't want anybody to feel like you're being guilt-tripped into having to cook with all of these ingredients. Because quite frankly, while I'm going to talk about some of these things, I highly doubt. I'm not going to say never, but there are certain parts that I am not sure I will ever personally eat. But it's at least nice to know what you can do with them, just in case in the future you have to do something with them. So let's jump right into it. And we're going to kind of go up. This is at least based on my gut reaction, my thought processes on from the least adventurous all the way up to the most adventurous. So the first thing we'll talk about are the necks. It's certainly not a gross piece. I wouldn't say for most people, it's not a gross piece of the chicken, but it's just, well, really, there's not a lot of meat on them, their bones. Or if there is a lot of meat, it is to a certain extent tough to get that meat off. But chicken necks are still very, very good for stock. Also, some people who recommend deep frying them like you would a chicken wing. So I don't know. Give it a whirl. See what you how you make out with that. But certainly, you can take those necks, throw them in to make stock or broth. The second thing is liver. Now, this is something that it is fairly common. Chicken liver pate you usually can find at, I would say, many grocery stores. I don't know if all grocery stores carry them. I'm not a fan of most chicken liver pates. There are a couple of recipes I'm interested in trying out, but chicken liver pate has never been high on my list of things that I really enjoy. In fact, I don't really enjoy chicken liver that much. And for me, mainly it's a texture thing. Chicken liver has a tendency to be a little bit on the mushy side, but it can also have that strong, almost leaning towards a bitter taste. And I just don't really care for that. Now, they do say that if you soak the liver in buttermilk, it can keep it from tasting so strong. So I'm probably going to try that the next time that I try to cook chicken liver. But chicken liver, as I said, it can be used to make pate, it can be fried up, it can be used in giblet pie, it can be used in giblet gravy. And there's a style of Japanese cooking called yakitori. Please don't hold me to that pronunciation, but I believe that's how it's pronounced, which is simply to cook on bamboo skewers, and they will do chicken liver that way. Next up is the heart. Now, honestly, folks, this is one of my favorite pieces of chicken. Yes, of the entire chicken, chicken heart is one of my favorite pieces. It's a bit chewy, but it is so, so good. I've always loved it. I liked it as a kid. But once we moved to Brazil, it is a very popular dish at churrascarias and rodízios. And what they do is they will just put it on spits and they will grill it over a fire. And folks, it is absolutely amazing. I absolutely love, 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 love chicken hearts. Now, as I said, it can be grilled. You just want to make sure you don't overcook it. So 2 to 3 minutes per side should be nice. But it can also be used in giblet gravy or giblet pie, or in a dish from France called alicot. And again, please don't hold me to these pronunciations, but alicot is basically a giblet stew. They throw all the giblets in the stew pot with, I don't know, a variety of things. And it's supposed to be this really hearty, hearty dish. Now, next up are the gizzards. The gizzards are another part of the chicken that I really do enjoy eating. I've enjoyed them, again, since I was a child. But they are certainly more chewy than the heart. And they have a definitely a tougher texture to them. One thing you need to keep in mind with gizzards is that they must be cleaned properly. If you are processing a chicken for the first time, what you're going to do with the gizzard is you're going to cut it on the narrow edge, so to speak. It's kind of hard to explain, but you know your gizzard has kind of a rounded edge, but then it kind of comes to a narrow point. And you want to cut down that and open it up, almost butterfly it. And then there's a membrane that you need to peel off. And that's kind of the inner part of the stomach, which is in essence what the gizzard is. You want to peel that off and then wash it down real good, and then you'll be good to go. The gizzards can be used, again, in giblet gravy, giblet pie, or another great way to enjoy gizzards is deep fried. I absolutely love deep fried chicken gizzards. In fact, I met up with a friend of mine a couple of years ago down south. I hadn't seen her in, I don't know, doesn't matter. I hadn't seen her in 20 years, and I was passing through, and she recommended that we go to this place called the Beacon Diner, and there you could get a plate of deep-fried chicken gizzards, and whew, boy, were they good. But then again, down south, they fry everything, and you can pretty much fry cardboard, and if you fry it right, it's going to taste great. So, I don't know. No, but I do. I love gizzards. Gizzards are very, very good. Now, up to this point, everything that we've talked about are things that I have tried from a chicken. The neck, the liver, the heart, the gizzards. The next item we're going to talk about are the feet. I have not yet eaten feet or cooked at all with feet. I tried to, if you again follow us on Instagram or on Facebook, and I may have even mentioned this on the podcast. In fact, I believe I did. Back when we butchered our chickens in May, my plan was to use the feet to make broth or stock, but I failed miserably at the cleaning piece. I didn't read the instructions correctly, and so I kind of screwed that all up. My goal, though, is to do this correctly next time around. And in fact, when we butchered my dad's chickens the following week, he was gracious enough to give me his feet. I have them in the freezer, and hopefully one of these days I will get them out and I will go ahead and give this another try. But with the feet, the first thing you need to keep in mind is that they must be cleaned properly. Obviously, they've been running around, and I don't even care how clean you keep your chicken yard. If you keep them on grass, you're moving them around, they're still going to be running through poop. I mean, it just is what it is. And so you need to make sure that you wash them thoroughly. And then what you do is you dip them in simmering water for about 30 seconds. You put them into an ice bath. And then there's an outer layer of skin that you've got to peel off. And then finally, there's a toenail that you can pop off, or some people will just chop the ends of the toes off because that will help release the collagen that is in the chicken feet. Keep in mind, chicken feet do not have meat. They are bones and collagen. That's it. So it's basically flavor and a thickening agent. And so they can be used in broth as the thickening agent, but they can also be used in oriental cooking. In fact, my buddy Jack Polner over at the Mindful Homestead, when he saw I was trying to take those chicken feet and turn them into stock, or into broth, I should say. He said, why are you wasting them on that? You need to make some dim sum. Well, I am not an oriental cooking master, but who knows? One of these days, maybe I will give dim sum a try as well. But definitely the feet are something that is, in fact, in Brazil, they will actually barbecue the feet and people just suck the collagen right off the bone, so to speak. So definitely, and I know it's not just Brazil, other places do that as well. There's probably other uses for the feet, but those are just some of the ones that I'm aware of. Now we're at the cockscomb. the part of the chicken that kind of started this entire podcast episode. Not the entire podcast. That would be weird. This episode. So to cook with a cockscomb, what you need to do, first of all, is trim the cockscomb off of the top of the skull. Now, even hens have a comb, but by and large, the hens' combs are not going to be big enough to deal with, to mess with. There are some breeds, I'm thinking of the Leghorns, whereby the comb might be worth messing with. But by and large, the reason why they call it cockscomb is because it's coming from the rooster, from the cock. And so those are, generally speaking, those combs are going to be bigger and easier to work with. So you trim them off of the skull. And what you need to do, first of all, is boil them, blanch them, and then carefully peel off the outer layer of skin. Now, from my understanding, I have never eaten these. I'm not going to say never, but this is not one of the things that's on my list. But from my understanding, the texture of this is rather rubbery, as it's mainly cartilage. There are some people, some chefs, who will use it kind of straight up in salads. They'll braise it, maybe put it in a little bit of a broth. And in French and Italian cuisines, they can also be used as part of certain sauces. So that's how the cockscomb can be used. Now, I'm not quite sure how my friend's wife's friend, coworker, who's from South America somewhere, like I said, I believe it's Ecuador. I'm not quite sure how she uses them. So I'd be interested in maybe finding that out. But certainly, it is a piece of the chicken that can be used. Now, we're on to another fun one, the testicles. First of all, yes, roosters have testicles, and yes, you can eat them. And as I did some research into this, I found a couple of ways, and I'm sure this is not an exhaustive list by any stretch of the imagination, but a couple of ways that these can be used. First of all, there is a Hungarian recipe called kakasír porkot. Now, I'm sorry if I'm butchering that. All of my I did find that looking at my stats, at one point, we were like the number 5 podcast, home and garden podcast in Hungary. So I might have some Hungarian fans out there who can speak to this recipe. So if you're one of them, drop me an email, brian@thehomesteadjourney.net. I would love to hear from you, first of all, on how badly I've butchered the name. And number 2, how common is this recipe in Hungary? But kakasír porkot, which is basically rooster nut stew. Okay, so Google it if you want some more information. And then in Oriental cooking, particularly in Chinese cooking, the rooster testicle is seen as an aphrodisiac and are usually served in a broth with mushrooms or vegetables prepared rather simply. So if you're feeling adventurous, now you probably could do like people do with pig testicles and beef testicles, and you could probably deep fry them as you can fry anything. And maybe that will taste great as well. If you decide that you want to try that out or you have tried that out, again, I'd love to hear from you. Let me know what you thought. And I will definitely pass that information on to everybody else. Finally, today, we are going to talk about the head. Now, this is one where it's getting a little out there for me, I'll be honest. And this is coming from somebody who actually really enjoys fish head soup, fish head stew, and I can eat a fish head like nobody's business. But there's just something about a chicken head that I'm just not quite sure whether or not I could do it. Now, I never say never. You know, sometimes hunger is the best seasoning. But this is not one that I plan on adding to my repertoire, at least not right now. But people say you can use the chicken head in stock. So when in doubt, throw it in the stock pot. I guess in the Philippines and other places, it is a street food. It's considered a delicacy and they deep fry them. And some people really, really like cracking the heads open and sucking out the brains. Now, I know that sounds a bit gross and I apologize, but that is what some people do. And it is one of those things that I think sometimes we as Americans, and I speak like that to you because the vast majority of my podcast listening audience based on my statistics are from the U.S., but we do have a tendency sometimes to turn our noses up at certain things, and who knows, maybe chicken head is absolutely delicious, but I don't think I'm going to give it a whirl anytime soon. If you have, let me know. Let me know what you thought. But it's just not high up on my list of things. Even in the spirit of beak to butt, I'm not quite sure I can swallow that one. Who knows? Maybe someday I'll give it a whirl. Now, there is one other piece that I had thought about talking about, and that is the kidneys. Chickens do have kidneys, but they're very small, and they're actually the kind of the little thing that sometimes you can find on the underside of a thigh. But honestly, when I was doing some Googling on it and researching chicken kidneys and whether or not you could cook with them, I found some references that maybe you could put them in kidney pie, but I don't know how many kidneys you would need to come up with kidney pie. And many people confuse gizzards with chicken kidneys. Chicken gizzards are not the kidneys of the chicken. Chickens actually have kidneys, and the gizzard is more like their stomach. So I didn't include kidneys on here. Maybe I should have, but that's the reason why I kind of skipped over that. So are there some other parts and pieces that I missed? Are there some recipes that you have for any of these things? The neck, the liver, the heart, the gizzard, the feet, the cockscomb, the testicles, the head, or even the kidneys? I'd love to hear from you. Drop me an email, brian@thehomesteadjourney.net, or connect with me over on our social media accounts. You can send me messages on Facebook and Instagram, and I am pretty good about responding to those. Hopefully, you've not found this gross and off-putting. Rather, you found this informative, interesting, and who knows, maybe you've been challenged to try something a little bit new. All right, folks, that's it for this episode. Thanks so much for tuning in. If you haven't already, I'd really appreciate it if you jump on over to iTunes or Stitcher, your favorite podcast platform, and leave us a review, a thumbs up, whatever they allow. If you haven't already, I'd also appreciate it if you would share this with your friends, people that you think might find this podcast entertaining and informative. And finally, if you haven't already, jump on over to thehomesteadjourney.net and take a look. You can also find us on Facebook, on Instagram, and also on YouTube. And so if you haven't subscribed or followed us on all of those places, definitely do so, and that will help you keep up to date with everything we have going on here on The Homestead. As always, the music on this episode was provided by audionautics.com, so thank you to them. And until next time, everybody, keep up the good work.